The Wurkkos TS10 has long been a favorite among enthusiasts for its small size, low price, and impressive feature set. This is the updated V2, and while not perfect, I can see why it's so popular. But now we have the HD10, and it's even better. These are 14500-based triple emitter lights with RGB auxiliaries and the Anduril 2 firmware. The TS10 is similar to the Lumitop FWAA, with a rear tail switch and a captive inner tube that appears to solve the issues with the larger Lumitop and Noctagon button designs. This switch, however, has a very low travel and is pretty mushy, making it not good, in my opinion. The HD10, on the other hand, has a very nice clicky button with an indicator LED which is easy to use while being recessed to prevent accidental activation. This light also includes a well-sealed USB charging port and has a magnet in the tail cap. There is a simple headband included as well, and the tube can be reversed to mount the clip in either direction. The TS10 has a large bezel sealing the optic, which, as you might be able to notice, I had some difficulties trying to remove. The HD10 bezel is press fit and would be even more difficult to get off. Both lights are very powerful for their size, with the HD10 producing over 1600 lumens at its peak after a fresh charge. This is really impressive and fun to use at night. The TS10, on the other hand, is driven too hard, with max output hitting 1745 lumens, at which point the emitters are clearly overdriven and turn blue, which is likely to cause lasting damage with repeated usage. Burning emitters were a problem in previous versions, and I'm disappointed to see that crop up again in this V2 model. Wurkkos should have used a slightly less powerful driver here, as it's just the top couple output levels that overdrive the emitters. Also, this only happens on a fresh charge because it's using a FET driver. Thankfully, it does run Anduril 2, which means that max output can be limited to prevent the burning. I have a full video on that process that I will link for reference. After thermal calibration, all that power was managed quite well in these tiny hosts. Yes, it gets very hot in the hand, but the lights were able to sustain over 180 lumens on turbo for over an hour. The hotter TS10 sees a pretty dramatic fall in the first 30 seconds, but recovers to 350 lumens at 1 minute, and as the battery dies, it manages to sustain about 250 lumens for the last 15 minutes of its run. This may be the best, low-cost way to try out Anduril 2. However, there are some issues with the implementation. The inclusion of full RGB aux is awesome, I love that feature, but for some reason, the light apparently considers the auxiliaries to be a secondary main channel. Normally, a triple press cycles between smooth and stepped output ramps, but in multi-channel lights, this instead switches the channel mixing. For some reason, these lights think that the red and yellow auxiliaries together are a secondary channel, but only sometimes. Both lights will occasionally and seemingly randomly switch between changing ramping styles on a triple click and toggling between light and a phantom channel, let's call it. Again, this seems completely random and arbitrary. Maybe there's a repeatable and avoidable reason, but regardless, it's very annoying. I am naturally not the only one to have experienced issues with the pre-production models, you know, makes sense, and supposedly Wurkkos will fix it, but as it stands, just be aware of this. The TS10V2 has easily accessible flashing pads, while sadly, the HD10 does not. These lights are equipped with the conveniently named Lattice Power CSP2323 LEDs, which are similar to the Nichia E17A. They are high CRI and provide excellent neutral tints, though they're a bit greenish on the lower levels. The optic used is excellent, and overall the beam is very pleasant with its 4000K temperature and lack of artifacts. The pattern is well balanced for general EDC use, quite floody at 3.7 candela per lumen. The price for these lights is shockingly low. The TS10 is only $34 with battery at normal price, and often on sale for just $20. The HD10 is slated to run about $25. For a fully featured Anduril hot rod with RGB aux, high CRI emitters, and a dual tube tail switch, or included USB-C charging, that is an absolute steal. However, these are lights that should probably only be purchased for and used by enthusiasts who are already into the hobby or are looking to really get into it. The design quirks and complicated interface in conjunction with the high output on offer make this, in my opinion, inappropriate and potentially even dangerous for someone unfamiliar with modern high power lights, unless of course they're willing to spend a bit of time learning how to use them. If you are an enthusiast, then these lights come highly recommended for me. Just be aware of the quirks. Between the two, I definitely prefer the HD10. I think it's a better overall design and hasn't had as many issues for me. It's arguably more versatile with its included headband strap and USB-C port, and I like the clicky button much more than the TS10's mushy thing. Now, in this size, I do prefer a dual-fuel flashlight. While I have heard that the HD10 will get a dual-fuel buck-driven version, supposedly, I've heard rumors about that anyway, but I certainly don't have one. If you want a more practical 14500 size headlamp, then the Scalehunt H150 is a great dual-fuel option, and the MSR D3AA is a more premium and versatile pick than the TS10V2. I think both of those are a step up in terms of quality and practicality, but the Wurkkos lights are really all you need in this class, and are plenty of fun. Well, that's it for this one. Wurkkos sent me both lights free of charge, and the HD10 came a few weeks ago so I could get this video out when the product launches. A first for me. It usually takes months post-release for a video to get out. Anyway, I was not otherwise paid or compensated for this review. So if you enjoyed this video, then thanks.